Hello, I'm Grandmaster Mikhail Marin, and we'll continue investigating some of the most interesting moments in the top games at the World Youth Chess Championship, held in Mamaia, Romania. As the tournament advances, we are already in round 8 out of 11. The pressure on the leaders becomes higher and higher because the importance of each point increases. And of course, it is always a good question how to deal with this pressure. Should you continue playing for a win or start playing safely to maintain the advantage? I remember an old amusing comment by Shirov, written maybe 3 decades ago. Alexei referred to two of his games in the last round games and decisive games. In both of them, he got a losing position out of the opening, but he won in both cases. In one of them, he needed to win, and in the other one, a draw would have been enough for winning the tournament. And Alexei finishes his comment with a rhetorical question. Well, if I play for a win, I get into a losing position. And if I play for a draw, then the same happens. Maybe I should play for a loss. Well, of course, this is only a joke, but in some general meaning, we will see all these situations reflected in the games selected for today. I have arranged the games not according to the categories, but to the situation corresponding to them. So we'll start with this game, played in the girls under 18 tournament. Maria Mkrtchyan was in lead with a perfect score, 7 out of 7. Not bad. And she was playing with the only player with 6 points. So we can see that the leadership takes some shapes already at this stage. Black played a very ambitious system, knight c6. It leads to very double-edged play. Of course, should have been happy to win and catch up with the leader. And other players might have chosen the move queen a4, which is known to be safe, because white more or less retrieves the pawn. But at the same time, wasting so much time with the queen allows black to complete her development. Instead, she went without hesitation after 16 seconds for a short castle, when it's already clear that white will not retrieve the pawn. Knight c3, b5, and now knight e5. This used to be a specialty of Glazerov, an outstanding Catalan specialist some decades ago. I assume he's still playing it. He has been playing it for the whole life. And this leads to a slightly paradoxical position. It seems that black has almost 2 extra pawns because white has no real majority on the king side. But white is better developed and has more space, and this makes things more complicated. Glazerov used to play this variation where white has just a normal compensation for the pawn. But Mariam played queen c2 almost instantly. And this seemed to be a surprise for her opponent, who thought for 28 minutes. Queen c2 was virtually unknown earlier. But recently, Daniil Dubov has played it. And we know that Dubov has many interesting ideas in the Catalan. So white simply wants to develop. Of course, taking on e5 is a bit dangerous. What about the development, no? The Dubov game continued with bishop b7. Bishop here, h6, rook takes here. And now the only playable moves would have been h takes g5 with complicated play. Now both bishop e7 and bishop d6 are playable. Pankratov played queen takes d7, and this is just lost. Black still has a material advantage, 2 rooks and a pawn for the queen. But the queen is very active, and the rooks do not communicate. And also the bishop is undeveloped yet, so white won rather quickly. Ayan played b4, and actually this is not a good idea. First of all, this weakens the pawn on c4, and it also wastes tempo, helping the knight to go where it would like to go. We see that white is in no hurry to retrieve the pawn. She just develops, and actually this is a very good idea in the Catalan. Now the pawn on a7 is, I mean the square, bishop a7 in general can cause some discomfort to the rook. And black played rook b5. Of course, she tries to do the best out of her position. b5, b4 has consumed two tempi, but at the same time it cleared some space for the rook. And now white decided to defend the pawn with f4, which could have spoiled the advantage. Queen takes c4 was very strong, with a clear advantage for white. Pawns are equal now, and there will be time for f4 later, because if rook e5, then bishop f4, and black loses an exchange. For instance, if rook here, this knight d6 takes, and white is simply winning. After f4, the most logical move would have been rook d5. Once you lift the rook, you should centralize it. Probably both players overlooked and the position remains unclear. Both players must have overlooked that queen c4 runs into knight takes e5, eliminating a very important pawn because the rook on d1 is hanging. Black played the bishop a6 after almost 6 minutes, and this was a decisive mistake because now black loses material. The pieces are hanging, and is just a decisive material advantage for white. The game continued for another 18 moves, but nothing could be changed. So what was interesting in this game was that the player with white was in a lead of a full point, didn't go for safety, queen a4. She went for the sharpest variation, because she didn't want to maintain her advantage. She wanted to go all the way to continue winning. And this is actually the right policy. You should not weaken lower your focus. This is what Fischer used to do, and he was criticized for that, unjustly, unrightly criticized, that when he was leading in a tournament, he would continue playing for a win. They thought that was childish. But I don't think it's like this. It's good to know that in any moment, any situation, you are ready to play for a win. We have the same situation in this game. Mungzul had only 6.5 points. She had made a draw, and her opponent had 6. The game was less, let's say, the variant. White's decision were less critical than in the previous game, but it was actually black who helped her opponent to win, in a way. We have some normal knight of structure with the small detail that this pawn is here, implying some space advantage but also some relative weakness. But in this structure, one of the most important things is this square. And actually, black could have solved that problem radically. If now this, then rook d8. If takes like this, e takes d5 to keep c2 defended, but then bishop c5, and suddenly three white pawns are hanging. Black will restore the material equality, and the play is about equal. Black decided to keep the things are there with king f8. She didn't want to get castled because probably she preferred to have the rook here. Maybe later she was thinking of advancing the pawn. So she decided to connect the rooks this way. It's a bit complicated, but it's not necessarily bad. I'd like to play knight d5. There is not much she can do. It is obvious that white cannot keep the control of the d5 square with pieces. But there is this famous quote by Nimzowicz, who wrote that such a square can be converted into a strong pawn. True, he had in mind situations where there is no pawn here. Let's say the pawn could be here. And then after the exchange, a strong square transforms into a strong pawn, a strong passed pawn. But even with a pawn on d6, the same can apply. And now black made a practically decisive mistake. Bishop takes d5. I know I have been playing the knight of so many times, and I know that there is this temptation to keep a knight against the bishop, hoping that the knight would be a good knight and the bishop would be a bad bishop. But things are not that simple, actually, because, okay, with so many, so much space for white, there is no talk about bad bishops. Moreover, in this concrete position, there is this weakness on f5. The bishop should have stayed on board in order to defend that square. And, for instance, here, this is just a normal position with chances for both sides. Each player has a mobile majority. Play remains unclear. So now we see this weakness on f5, and we can also talk about the strengths of this pawn, because with such a pawn, white has the potential possibility of massive pawn attack, and black not always can react on the king side. Black tried to fight for space on the queen side, but now the second aspect became clear. White is better developed. Black didn't manage to connect the rooks yet. And now knight c4. Actually, I like this move, knight c4. It's not the only move, but white understands that she does not need to place the knight here. I mean, that's a good idea in general, but now there are concrete things to do. So white was very flexible in thinking. And now she just develops her queenside initiative. The threat is rook b3. Rook here. We can see that black doesn't get any single moment for playing king g7 and developing the reserve rook. And now rook takes e7, simply wins material, and okay, actually black resigned here. So these were the, let's call them, positive, inspiring situations when the player in the lead developed the advantage in the tournament. This is what you have to do. Well, sometimes in the last round you may think of making a draw, but not playing for a draw. I mean, if this is enough for a win, but with a few rounds to go, of course you have to keep the risk. Of course, the player in the lead not always can do that. We have this game in the girls under 14 section, Nurguliyeva against Amulia. Black, the player with black had 6 points, and her opponent had by half a point less. Without trying to hurt anybody's feelings, this game looked a bit like playing for a loss. It was obvious that black was somehow too much under pressure and treated the opening rather poorly. Now d5 is somehow the most reliable move, and it's a slightly unusual version of the Alapin system, c3 system, but still it remains playable for black. After bishop g7, things become a bit harder. the main continuation is c takes d4, d5, and now e5. Of course, the black can try to play against the pawn on d4 somehow in this, let's call it, Sicilian Caro-Kann hybrid. Bishop e5 is considered to be the strongest move. In principle, white is better, but this is the way to play it. I'm very surprised that black played the next move, knight c6, after little bit more than 1 minute. Was it opening preparation? Was it just impatience, nervousness because of the situation? I'm in the lead. I have to keep my advantage. Because knight c6 is bad for many reasons. For instance, d5. But white has gained several tempi if we compare it with a Baroni. But d takes c5 is the simplest move, and white simply won a pawn. Black continued to play very quickly. I mean, okay, only on queen c7 she spent 2 minutes. So I remember I have played such important games at a junior level, and I remember that, okay, things have gone very well in the tournament for you, but you meet an opponent which causes some stress to you, or simply the situation in the tournament is stressful, and you don't have the patience to just sit and think, because okay, this position should have been part of the preparation of the player with black. I mean, okay, if you play g6 and bishop g7, you expect c3 and d4. Okay, d4 is also possible, but this is one of the main lines. So only now she played queen c7, but actually there is not much to do. It felt like black continued playing very quickly. It felt like black couldn't simply be there, present in the game. Well, the game lasted for very long, actually, but there was no doubt that white is winning anyway. It's an extra pawn and a completely normal position. I should also notice that there is a huge rating difference between the players. Of course, at this age, such things can happen. I have mentioned a case when a player had no rating at all. So you don't see very frequently games between players separated by more than 800 points. Well, earlier this would have been impossible, but now ratings start, I don't even know from where they start, probably 1,000 or 1,200, I don't even know that. Okay, it's some modern chess issue. Now, we'll see a slightly better situation for the player in the lead. Vedohin had 6.5, and he played with Ansat with 6 points, and he got into a passive position with white. So we can see that black has everything he wants. Actually, his position was lost at some point, but he managed to hold somehow. So black played h5. Of course, he can do whatever he wants. He has so much space. White is almost paralyzed. e3 was a desperate threat. Of course, knight f3. Black calculated well, because this position is quite bad for white. The threat is bishop h3 followed by mate, so this is forced. Now queen f6. The pawn is still hanging. Probably the best move is g4, relatively best, but after rook d5, black has a huge attack. He has an advantage. King g2 doesn't work because of bishop d5. And I have entertained myself analyzing a bit the move h4, which looks solid. Then suddenly rook takes d3 is very strong. Retrieves the pawn with an obvious advantage, because if white takes, then black has to be accurate. Actually, I don't know what had happened if the game had gone like this. Because now, for instance, queen f3, threatening mate with bishop h3, is bad, because the king just escapes and white is a rook up. So first of all, check. The king has to define its intentions. If king g1, then queen f3. So king e2, now bishop g4, check. The king has to go back, because if king d2, then rook d8. So the king goes here, now queen f3. And now there is no time for rook here, because of queen h1 mate. This is because the bishop is on g4. I don't know how much the players have seen of all this, But white didn't take the knight. Now bishop d5 would have been a strong move, but king, I like king g8 too. Now white can forget about taking on f3 at all. And of course black has a fantastic position. White has weaknesses everywhere. Only that now, having reached such a good situation, he didn't continue consequently. He should just go king g7. If allowed to play rook h8 and rook takes h4, black is obviously winning. The pawn on h3 will be lost. h5 is probably forced, but here the white king doesn't feel so comfortably either. The rook will go to g8 and king h6, h8, I don't know where. So it's still a big advantage for black. Black decided to play on both wings, but it's not such a good idea because he doesn't have resources to finish the play on the king side. Maybe at a later stage this move would have been okay. And now suddenly white got back into the game. D5, queen takes e5, and the position is not simple at all. Actually, chances are roughly equal eventually. Black's position is a bit easier to play because the white king is vulnerable. Eventually, black reached a queen ending with an extra pawn, which he couldn't win. And the game lasted 146 moves. But black managed to make a draw and maintain his leadership. Things are only partly similar in this game. The player with white, Razafindratsima, had 6.5 points. Then his opponent was one of the players with 5.5 points. Of course, white didn't play for a draw. I mean, it's a sharp variation with mutual attacks on the opposite wings. Typical Sicilian. Only that now he took a wrong decision. He played f4. In such positions, speed is essential. So he should have prepared g6 as quickly as possible, because we see that the black pawns are already there. He played f4, which is a rather slow plan. And it also weakens the pawn on e4. And this gives black a few tempis. Now knight c7, the knight which seemed to be passive on e8 suddenly goes to b5. f5 doesn't threaten that much. f6, okay, it's not the end of the world. And actually, it's strange that after f6, none of the players noticed the move knight c3. The knight is taboo because after b takes c3, b takes c3, the queen is lost. And otherwise, black simply wins the exchange. Bishop f8 is just a typical reaction. Nothing happens on the king side. There is no danger for black. And now white decided to take on b4. What to do? Because if king here, then a3. And of course, it looks very bad for white. Again, if b3, then knight c3 wins an exchange. Otherwise, black will have a decisive attack. So he took this pawn d5. Bishop c5, what to do? If queen e1, then check, for instance, d takes e4, the bishop doesn't have good squares, c2 is in some trouble. So bishop c5, takes here, queen b4, and the white tries to survive somehow. His pieces were hanging, so he had to pin the bishop. And, well, I would also talk a bit about another aspect, psychological aspect. The player with white, the leader, has a decent rating already, 2431, almost 200 points more than his opponent. Of course, it's not 800 like in the previous game. But okay, such ratings are probably more real, closer to the player's strength. And well, playing resolutely for a win against a higher rated opponent who is in the lead also requires some courage, let's say. But black was not intimidated yet, And he went for this. I cannot call it combination because actually it gains material, two rooks for the queen. And he reaches a winning position. The problem is that the knight is passive, the e pawn is dangerous, and the white king is in some danger on light squares, especially. Only that now he kind of lost the threat. The bishop was well placed on d1 yet, and e3 would have been a very strong move. The point is that white cannot play the same move as in the game, because now the pawn on b3 is lost and the king is in decisive danger. So if queen e4, bishop here, status bishop g6, takes, queen takes e4, and rook takes e4, and it's obvious that black has a decisive attack. There is no way white can defend his king already. He went bishop g4. He wanted to go to f5, but okay, this is not the best moment to do that, because now white managed to play b3, and suddenly the king gets some space on dark squares. This already, you know, white immediately grabbed his chance. Sometimes 200 rating points are obvious only in such moments. This was the first chance to stay alive with white, and he grabbed it. So this maybe experience, the strength doesn't manifest itself from the first move, but somewhere in the decisive phase. So white used this chance, and now once again black didn't choose the best trajectory for the bishop. He went bishop f3, okay. If he went bishop g4, if he retreated with the bishop, why to lose a tempo now? Because the bishop is also a bit passive there. Bishop f5 would have maintained some advantage, for instance g6, just securing everything. And now the bishop on f5 is useful because there is such a possibility. Let's say white plays b4, it looks logical, no? e5, and now the bishop has the e6 square, but also it can defend this rook, because this was one of black's problems, how to free this rook for going to an attack. And now the bishop can achieve that. After bishop f3, the position remains only slightly better for black. White is almost safe. Possible, okay, for instance, if e5 takes, the rook can still not advance to d1 because the colleague is hanging. But still, after bishop h5, in principle, black should be a bit better. We cannot know how the game could have continued, because in this moment, white offered a draw. And now was the second moment when the rating difference came to tell. Probably black understood that it's not so simple already. And okay, the respect paid to his higher rated opponents made him accept a draw. But all in all, this was a positive game. I mean, the players were fighting. And okay, maybe they were getting into time trouble here. And the draw, we cannot call it a premature draw. Well, things are a bit different in the last game we are going to examine. The player with black was in the lead with 6 points, and his opponent had only 5.5. And moreover, black has a fantastic position. There are several good moves here. For instance, bishop takes f3. If queen f3, then bishop b6 defends the extra pawn. If g takes f3, then the structure is simply bad. Knight d4, c5, bishop b6, with a clear advantage for black. f5 is also possible. f5, now there is an unpleasant pin, and c5 against black. Again, black is much better. I can only assume, I can only guess what happened here. player with black or one of them might have offered the draw, which is completely illogical because okay, you you have an extra half a point, and you have a fantastic position. I mean, you should just win. You should just go for the win, and then of course the chances to win the gold medal would increase. So one of the players offered a draw. I assume, I cannot be sure, but you will agree with me when you see the rest of the game. The problem is that there is this rule, you cannot make a draw before move 30. Unless there is a stalemate, move repetition, perpetual check, whatever. And I remember last year, I was playing against a young opponent, very, very talented. I got into an unpleasant position after 15 moves, let's say. And then he offers a draw. And we had this rule, about 30 moves. So I told him, sorry, we cannot. But, well, if you want to sidestep the rules, there is always a way. Because in such a situation, players could agree quietly, silently, so that nobody hears them, and said, let's just repeat the moves. And this is how the game ended. I think it was more than enough. They could have done this until move 30, actually. So, well, I'm not actually not so much concerned about playing against the rules, because after all, okay, it's a repetition. What can you say? But I don't understand the player with black having such a position, unless the game had been arranged even before it start. But then they would have chosen some other opening. Because, okay, this position, I mean, to get such a position with black and not play for a win, what a pity, no? So I hope this is not a mistake on the digiboards, because this is how the game is recorded on the servers. But anyway, it's a pity that, I mean, remember White's decision in the first game to go for the sharp Catalan line, not for the safe one. Well, in a position which remains unclear. And here, when everything is almost clear, Black has good winning chances to accept a draw or offer a draw and even organize this small masquerade with the king moves. It's not something that at least young players should do. So anyway, there are three rounds left, so we'll only see how the leaders will continue dealing with the situation.